Our scripture lesson this morning is from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 24, verses 36 through 49. This can be found on page 1026 of your pew Bible if you want to read along. Listen now to the Word of God. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them, and he said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking that they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise up in your minds? Look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still did not believe it because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. And he told them, "This is what is written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I am going to send you what my Father has promised. But stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high." This is the word of the Lord.
Please, would you pray with me? All this, Lord, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. So next week, we're going to begin a set of studies in the book of Acts, or more accurately, the book should be entitled, I suppose, The Acts of the Apostles, or The Acts of the Holy Spirit. They get kind of mushed together there. In that book, Luke has given us a remarkably detailed account of the early years of the Christian church, the first 30 years or so. But the truth of the matter is that there would be no Acts of the Apostles. As a matter of fact, there wouldn't be any apostles to act were it not for one stunning fact. Peter put the matter this way in his first public sermon. This is what he said, as it's recorded in Acts chapter 2. "Jesus of Nazareth was handed over to you, and you put him to death by nailing him to the cross. But God raised him from the dead. God has raised this Jesus to life, and we are all witnesses to the fact." Well, there it is. If Jesus was not raised from the dead, there wouldn't be any church. If Jesus was not raised from the dead, world history would have taken a radically different course. None of us would be here. Our faith is grounded in the fact of the resurrection as it has been handed down to us in Scripture. And then later in his second pastoral epistle, Peter would write this: "We did not follow cleverly invented stories when we told you about the power and the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty." Peter made a really big deal of this resurrection of Jesus being an historical fact, a fact supported by all kinds of corroborating witnesses. So why is that important to us? Well, throughout history, new religions have cropped up inspired by charismatic people like Gautama Buddha or Muhammad. In more recent times, someone would write a book, and then a group would then make that book the textbook of their faith. That's what happened with Joseph Smith. It happened with Mary Baker Eddy. It happened with Harold Klimp, on and on. A whole parade of prophets who have dreamed up new religions, some with, frankly, great curb appeal. But Christians are weird. They hold that the Bible, and only the Bible, is the standard for faith and life. What sets the Bible apart from all other religious books, and the thing that distinguishes Christianity from all other religions, is that it is based in the historical fact of the resurrection of Jesus. If Jesus' resurrection were proven to be false, Christianity would collapse. But the truth of the resurrection changes everything. James Boyce pointed out the logic of this by noting in his inimitable way that the resurrection is a fact attested by hundreds of witnesses and an otherwise inexplicable change in his followers. And since the resurrection is a fact, it follows that Jesus is divine. He's God in human form. And since Jesus is divine, it follows that his words are true and reliable. And since his words are true, we should follow him obediently. Makes sense to me? And so my goal in these studies in Acts is not just to learn about our forebears in the faith, although God knows that's a very helpful exercise to know our history. But no, my dearest hope is that as we immerse ourselves in this remarkable document, we'll catch hold of the power and the simplicity of the gospel, just as the apostles did, and then live it. But before we get into that study of how the early church was built up, I think it wise for us to take a careful look at its foundation in the resurrection of Jesus. And for that, we have to go first to the last words of Volume 1 of Luke's Gospel. Think back, just briefly, over the story. I mean, just the last part of the story. I mean, following his baptism, and for about 3 years, Jesus carried on a public ministry marked by astounding miracles, incisive teachings, growing popularity, and also a gathering storm of opposition. And then within a one-week period, that's like between now and Friday, in a one-week period, his triumphal entry into Jerusalem led to confrontation, betrayal, arrest, a hurried trial, a brutal execution, and then the absolute stillness of death. 1 week, and it was all over. His lifeless body was laid in a borrowed tomb. The case was closed and sealed, with nothing left but memories and dashed hopes. And then something happened. A mystery that has baffled and challenged and inspired men and women ever since. This dead man was seen alive. And not just by one or two people who may have been hallucinating. He was seen by scores of people. In fact, one report says that on one occasion, over 500 people saw him. How are you going to explain that? Well, maybe the way to deal with the mystery is to simply confess with Scripture that, well, with God, all things are possible. Well, of course, that's true. But it doesn't necessarily follow that with God, all things are likely. And certainly doesn't mean that with God all things are understandable. I know, it's a mystery. The resurrection is a huge mystery. Now, it's no less true simply because it's a mystery. But being a mystery means that it's more difficult to fit it into our well-ordered way of looking at what we call reality. Because it doesn't fit very well. So it's my best guess that when God chooses to reveal himself in mystery, as he does here, it tends to shake some of our most rudimentary assumptions about what we think is reality. So let me suggest that the mystery of the resurrection of Jesus, as it's recorded in the final chapter of Luke's gospel, plays havoc with at least four of those time-honored assumptions that we carry around. The first assumption that the resurrection of Jesus explodes is the notion that dead people stay dead. Right? I mean, I don't mean to appear morbid, but there is a curious kind of security in knowing that death is final. Because if death is irreversible, there are few surprises. To put it bluntly, as long as dead people stay dead, they're very predictable. On the other hand, life, by definition, is unpredictable. People who are alive are just loaded with surprises, not all of which are necessarily pleasant. The women came to the tomb on that first Easter morning ready to make their peace with death, to lay a life to rest. And what happened? They ran headlong into the one question that was furthest from their minds. They were asked, "Why do you look for the living among the dead?" Luke notes that their first reaction was one of fear. I sometimes wonder what they were afraid of. Were they afraid of death? Or were they afraid of life? It's so unpredictable. According to Luke, the disciples had an equally difficult time with the women's report. They thought it was nonsense, he says. Apparently, they preferred the sad sense of death to the nonsense of life after death. But there it was. It was a report that, while in most cases dead people do stay dead, there is one glorious exception. And each of them had to deal with it. So do we. What do you make of the resurrection? The second assumption that the resurrection of Jesus scraps, and it's a close cousin to the notion that dead people stay dead, is the idea that dead hopes stay dead. Among the saddest words in the Bible, to me, were spoken by those two despondent disciples just a few verses back in Luke chapter 24 on the road to Emmaus. At verse 21, they say, "We had hoped that he was the one." We had hoped. Hope in the past perfect tense. Hope that's been washed out, erased. Hope that is now lost. A door slammed shut and bolted, never to be opened again. We had hoped. I recall one psychologist defining profound depression as the inability to see any options, the inability to see any alternatives. Boy, talk about depressed. If that's true, then this was a case of the worst sort of depression. We had hoped, they said, and by implication, but now there's nothing. What happens when hope dies? I'll tell you what happens. Your future becomes chained to your past, and that past will not set it free. Maybe you know somebody like that. They have no hope, apparently. The closest they can come to having a future is to rehearse what might have been, what could have been, what should have been, but cannot be. What a sorry state to believe that dead hopes stay dead. It happens more often than we may realize. It certainly happened to those two disciples. But then by the grace of God, along came this mystery. This one who had been their reason for living, who had been brutally taken from them, was sitting with them there in this inn at the table, and with simple servant hands, he took the bread and broke it. And it says, in that act of breaking the bread, the hammerlock that their past had on their future was broken. Luke says that they recognized him and they were so excited, they were so filled with hope, he says, that they couldn't wait to get back to Jerusalem. They just had to tell the others that the door to the future had just been blown open and nobody would ever be able to close it again. If you know somebody who believes that dead hopes stay dead, tell them there's someone you'd like them to meet. Introduce them to Jesus. Some folks say that dead people stay dead, and the resurrection says, well, not always. Some people are convinced that dead hopes stay dead, but the resurrection says, not necessarily. Here's a third assumption that the resurrection of Jesus explodes, and that is that hard evidence is irresistible. It's not uncommon to hear somebody say, look, if you can see, hear, smell, taste, and feel it, then you have to believe it. Oh, really? I find Scripture saying something really quite different. In fact, Luke says that while the disciples were still talking about the risen Lord appearing to Peter and to the others, Jesus himself stood among them and he said, peace be with you. It's probably a good thing for him to say under the circumstances since they thought they were seeing a ghost, Luke says. I love Eugene Peterson. In his New Testament paraphrase in the Message, this is how he has it go on at verse 38. He has Jesus say, don't be upset. And don't let all these doubting questions take over. Look at my hands. Look at my feet. It's really me. Touch me. Look me over from head to toe. A ghost doesn't have muscles and bones like that. And as he said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And they still couldn't believe what they were seeing. It was too much. It seemed too good to be true. I think Peterson really nailed it there. The fact is that some things, no matter how real they may be, will remain unbelievable to some. But for my money, the most remarkable thing is that even after his resurrection, the Lord didn't force himself on the skeptics. He still doesn't. He never short-circuits our intellect. He never robs us of the dignity, nor absolves us of the responsibility of making up our own minds about him. In a court of law, hard evidence may be, in fact, irresistible, but even the resurrected Lord has each one decide for himself or herself what to make of this mystery. Dead people stay dead? Not always. Dead hopes stay dead? Not necessarily. Hard evidence is irresistible? I doubt it. And there's one last assumption that the resurrection of Jesus explodes, and that is that only the strong survive. Well, I suppose that depends on what you mean by strong. Sometimes you'll hear people say, it's a jungle out there. And only the strong survive. And it's commonly assumed that by strong we mean aggressive. But there's another kind of strong. It's persistence. It's like a low voltage current. It just keeps on charging. Or it's like running water. Quiet, it's persistent, but eventually, inevitably, inexorably, it breaks through. Notice Jesus' words in verse 44. He says, everything must be fulfilled, but all in good time. And then he goes on at verse 46 to say, this is what was written. The Christ will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things. I'm going to send you what my Father promised, but stay in the city until you have been clothed with power from on high. Okay, let's talk Turkey for a minute. If the Lord Jesus really wanted to overpower the opposition with a show of strength, he could have made a shattering personal appearance in front of the Sanhedrin. He could have showed up on the doorstep of Pilate's palace and said, "You remember a couple of days ago you asked me what is truth? Well, here I am. The truth is, I'm back." You imagine what would happen if the resurrected Lord Jesus showed up at Caiaphas's house and said, "Remember the other night? What you said?" See, that kind of show of strength does not have staying power. It really hits hard when it hits, but then I said, Luke says that while Jesus was blessing his disciples, he left. God bless you guys, and he's gone. First they thought they had lost Jesus forever, and then he was back, but only for a time, and now here he's gone again. The hard evidence for any kind of hard sell has just vanished. I'm sure they had entertained the idea of taking Jesus along with them to show him off to the doubters, to silence the critics. But now, without that compelling physical evidence of Jesus' physical presence, how are they supposed to carry on as witnesses? Where would the disciples go? What would be their next move? Common sense would have dictated that they go into hiding. You know, just lie low until public attention has been directed elsewhere, and then it'd be safe to show their faces in public again. Yeah, they could have gone into hiding, but they didn't. And thank God the disciples weren't Presbyterians. I mean, if they had been, they probably would have formed a committee, done a feasibility study, a market sample. And that probably would have eaten up the first 10 years of church history. But they didn't, thank God. The risen Lord Jesus had given the disciples their commission to carry on as witnesses. They already got the word. And so they did just about the last thing you would have expected of them. Luke says that they returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple praising God. Right under the noses of those who had done the worst that they could to destroy them, and armed only with what they knew to be the truth in their own experience, they waited expectantly for the Lord to give them further direction. And when that power fell at Pentecost, they set about with a quiet, determined courage to turn the world upside down as they turned people to Christ. And that's the book of Acts. And that's what we'll be digging into beginning next week. Your assignment for next Sunday then, for this week, is to study Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. We'll start off small. Let's pray. Thank you. Not only for what you've done for us, Lord, but for what you're doing in us and for us and through us. In the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.